Welcome back. You're still watching The Rush Hour. I am Agatha Mhaise, and this segment particularly is called The Big Issue. We are talking about corruption in Uganda and, of course, the global index that was released. That is a corruption perception index that was released by Transparency International. I'm still sitting with David Kizito. He is the programs officer at Transparency International Uganda. And, of course, a man who needs no introduction, Job Matua, in the world of anti-corruption fighting.
Yes.
I want to give you 1 minute to complete the list of the effects of corruption on Ugandans.
Yeah, the effect and the, but before the effect and then a small case here I want to cite.
Yes.
Auditor General found that 6,000 ghost employees are on government payroll.
Mm-hmm.
6,000 Auditor General thing.
Mm.
And these earned 30 billion alone in 2023. Auditor General found that 81,000 government employees were overpaid.
Mm.
And they earned 63.86 billion.
Yes.
In this era of ICT, in this era of enhanced visibility, how can a ghost exist on a payroll? To the tune that we lose almost 100 billion to the ghost? Do you know how much money we are looking for to pay the intern doctors? Even right now, they have threatened to go on strike. This money, we would just save it to pay the intern doctor. And that would be the end of the story. Now they are threatening to leave the hospital. Almost 80% of the health service in the hospital is provided by intern doctor.
Yes.
So now, again, poor health will be escalated. People will die in hospital because of absence of health workers, because money that was to be used to pay the intern doctor has been stolen, been paid to ghost workers. What is government doing with those accounting officers? Is it possible for New Vision here to pay a ghost worker that the accounting officer cannot know?
Mm-hmm.
How big our districts are almost like villages this day.
Mm.
So therefore, the danger of corruption now goes to the health, our health. We are dying because of corruption, poor infrastructure. I have cited for you. The president was the other day complaining of a road which developed pothole in less than 2 years.
Two years, yes.
In fact, the president himself, I was very glad that he finally saw it.
Yes.
Eh? Poor infrastructure.
Mm.
We have security, compromise to our security.
Mm.
I have information, most of these police cameras are white elephant. They are not functioning because the memory card that was supposed to be part of this camera, the money for the memory card was eaten. So we have cameras which are there deceiving us that they are recording anything.
Yes.
When actually you can disable them very easily. So now security is being compromised. Development is being compromised. Money which is supposed to be allocated for development
is also being compromised. Job.
I just wanted to give you one thing. The Auditor General reported that 342 billion of PDM money was not disbursed in 2023.
Yes.
And I can tell you there is a village called Maganjo in Nabweru Division of Nansana Municipality.
Yes.
It has the word called Maganjo. It has 5 villages A to E.
Mm.
And in those villages only 137 people have received the PDM money. When 342.9 billion was not disbursed
during the year that it was supposed to be disbursed.
Yes,
I'm going to come back to the Auditor General's report.
Yes.
Shortly. I want to come back to Kizito to expand a little more on this perception index. We learned that this year you decided not to do the ranking. You just did the percentaging or the marks. Why did you remove the ranking?
The ranking, actually, in the data set, the rankings are there. But like I said, sometimes the rankings are misrepresentative. The first reason is that it's not always that we shall always rank 180 countries. There is a likelihood that data sources change within that country.
Mm-hmm.
So you find that there are scenarios where we've had less than 180, or there are scenarios where we've had more than 180 countries.
Yes.
So if you go by the rankings, it's not always a standard that we have probably 180 countries globally, and those will always be the standard. So
yes.
Because of that drop and rise in the countries, we said let's emphasize the score. But importantly, if you're to improve on your performance, it's the score that matters more than the rank.
Yes.
Because it's the score that gives you how much you're performing. The ranks can be used to compare between jurisdictions and countries, but within your internal capacity, we emphasize the mark. And
before I come back to Job, where do you think we are going wrong as Uganda?
There are several areas where we are going wrong. One of them is we have a lot of resource wastage, and also our monitoring systems on how we spend these resources, those systems are not strong enough. We have a few agencies. Actually, I'll call them many, but the resources they have to combat or to perform on their mandate, they don't have that entire capacity. So when you want to fight corruption in its entirety, you have to strengthen monitoring mechanisms. And that's very weak within Uganda. When you look at most of the projects that are running, PDM go to projects such as Operation Wealth Creation, you remember the youth livelihood programs.
Yes.
These were all good projects, but their performances was diluted by the fact that, you know, we don't have mechanisms to see how strong they are performing, but also to get feedback on how to improve future projects. And that's why we are seeing the same challenges overflowing into the PDM. But also, I hinted on it slightly, the coordination between these agencies that are combating corruption. You know, there is a fact that when you want to improve on your perception and performance, you have to build trust among the citizens. Then they can help you. But when you look at what we are doing, DPP has this case, IG has this other case, but how often do they meet as anti-corruption agencies to combat or tap on the same cause? That's been a challenge, but also the other is the access now to this information relating to corruption. We have a depository that if someone wants to assess Uganda, what's that one-stop center that you'll always go to find cases on the prosecutions on corruption or in ongoing cases? What's happening as a whole when it comes to, you know, assessing Uganda? I think that's still missing. Rwanda has tried to have that central depository that even the successes of CSOs or the NGOs, they are being recorded by government. I think that's lacking. In Uganda, we are more operating in silos, and that's why I think every now and then the president comes up with a new anti-corruption agency. Now we have the Investors Protection Unit. Next time, probably you'll find SFC monitoring roads and what like it is currently.
Yeah.
And yet that shouldn't be the case. But then the other important one is now how do we prosecute
We are going to get to prosecuting corruption and to give a job here an opportunity to tell me where are we going wrong. You gave these many tools that we have to fight corruption.
Yes.
Why aren't they working?
I want to be very, very particular on this question. First of all, I thank my co-guest here, David, for raising some of those issues. Number one, we don't have political will. I can state it with clarity without any fear of contradiction. We don't have political will to fight corruption, my dear. Why should the president sit on the same cabinet table with the minister who stole iron sheet? I want to inform you, even the pickups which we are donated by Ugandans to fight COVID disease. Some ministers allocated these pickups to themselves instead of them going to the hospital. Jesus of Nazareth and Muhammad of Mecca. What is this? Can you imagine a minister who got a vehicle of over 600 million again goes to grab the pickup which is meant to be for the DHOs to supervise health services in our district? RCC Anderson Burora has raised the red flag and is willing to publish their list and whatever. And I'm eagerly waiting, and I can tell you, I will hold a press conference. I hope you will come and cover me. Pickups which people donated, Ugandans donated to the government to fight COVID that are supposed to be reallocated to the district health services. Ministers allocated these pickups to themselves. So we have greed as number two. Greed. Omululu in Uganda. Our people are too greedy. You saw recently Parliament gave vehicles to retire the speakers
yes.
who are still government officials.
Yes.
Madam Rebecca is still the first deputy prime minister. Mm-hmm. She's entitled to a vehicle to that effect.
Yes.
His Excellency Sekandi is still senior presidential advisor with an office in Kingdom Kampala and entitled to vehicle to that effect.
Mm.
Somebody earning 60% of the money as a former deputy speaker, 60% of the money as a former speaker, 60% of the money as a former vice president was given a vehicle. And I'm told public service, Minister of Public Service, is again requesting for about 70 billion to buy the same people vehicle. Can you imagine? What level of greed is that? Really, how much can we do? Eh? What can we do? So greed is number two. Number three, we have wrong mindset of our people, of glorifying people based on wealth, glorify people based on their good faith and mind.
Mm.
A Ugandan can even dance for a corrupt idiot, who has the money and ignore an intelligent person who is fighting corruption. That's number two. Number three, we have lack of faith by citizens. If you are fighting corruption, the next thing will be allegation on you that you are looking for, you know, cheap popularity to get money. When I led the fight against the NSSF, some people even alleged that I was being paid by Honorable Minister Betty Amongi.
Yes.
I am going to run for a standing position with Honorable Minister Betty Amongi.
Mm.
The common interest there was fighting for the money of the people of Uganda. I was not in any way recruited or deployed by Honorable Minister Betty Amongi. Can you imagine the Parliament Committee even tried to follow my movement to retrieve some CCTV footage to follow whether in any way I have been moving together with Honorable Minister Betty Amongi? So the whistleblower was almost turned into a victim. If I was not a stout person.
Could that also be a problem whereby whistleblowers feel threatened?
Yes, people feel threatened. That's why many Ugandans cannot report. Because once you report corruption, you are turned into a victim. That's another danger. Once you report corruption, you are turned into a victim. The burden is shifted to you. Eh? So you are coming out is seen as if you want to witch hunt somebody. So that poor faith by Ugandan must be stopped.
Yes.
Then lastly, we have rotten institutions of government. Rotten. The people in, again, UNBS embezzled the money for marking fuel. Do you know that fuel has been marked? The petrol in Uganda is different from the petrol in Rwanda.
Yes, that's right.
Likewise, the petrol in Kenya, to avoid dumping.
Mm.
Officials in UNBS embezzled over 600 million for marking fuel. They are admitted, including the ED, Livingston Ebiru. They are admitted to the IGG and then went into a deal with IGG to refund the money while remaining in office. How on earth can Madam Betty Olive Namisango come here, keep a corrupt person who has pleaded guilty in the same office to refund the money? It is like saying you should steal more to repay what you had stolen. So these officials embezzled the money for marking fuel. They were just casually allowed to refund the money while they remained in office.
But that's the same thing that happened with the Mabati situation.
It is the same thing, even the same thing which IGG was reporting in the findings of NSSF, which eventually withdrew. So the institutions are too weak, they are rotten, they don't have courage to fight corruption. I disagree with my brother David about these institutions not being so much well-resourced. How much money did I have to effectively deal with the NSSF issue? Did I not do so? So this individual, you don't even need a mountain of human being to fight corruption.
Before I go back to...
You just need people to take up their responsibility, be patriotic, and fight corruption.
Before I go back to David, I want to ask you, in your opinion, Job, do you think that these institutions are also too many, that there is no consolidation when it comes to dealing with corruption?
No. They are still, the institutions we have now are enough. What is lacking is the courage of the individuals heading those institutions. I have information from Inspector General of Government. There are cases when Madam Betty Olive Namisango Kamya is advised by technical department, and she goes against their advice. So I actually want the president to remove her from that office, and we get a serious.
We are going to come back to your job.
IGG is very important.
Yes, that is very true.
It is an established office to fight corruption by Article 223 of the Constitution.
We are going to come back to your job. David, first of all, I want to give you an opportunity to speak on political will. Is this something that you saw in your research in other countries?
In most of the countries, and when you look at the recommendations that we have, we noted that where there is political interference in matters of fighting corruption, it distorts the spirit in which, you know, the anti-corruption agenda should move. But also within Uganda, there is always a mixed pill between political will. It's there, it's not there. But the first point of reference on our side is that from the political side, we've seen good laws being passed, but we've also seen that willingness of establishing agencies to combat corruption, even where we think some agencies may not be as much necessary or as they should be. So there is that argument that we still have some bit of political will, that if it wasn't there, probably wouldn't be even where we are. Now, where the challenge then comes
in is... Don't
you
think the political will goes beyond just putting an office?
Yeah, so where the challenge then comes in is that beyond these offices, we have issues of... could we call it favoritism? We have this where people connected to the system are normally left off the hook. And I think Ugandans have that thing we now call the big fish, small fish syndrome. That people that are in high political positions, there's a way the law doesn't bite them. If you look at most of the corruption cases that have been involving ministers from way back, you see that most of these ministers have been left off the hook. But then they are taking core personnel or the support officers under them are the ones that face the long arm of the law. So that's where now we have that mix of we have this political will or not. But the challenge is, like I think it started with, is that in a democratic...
Just 20 seconds.
I want to give him information.
That
Honorable Minister Goretti wrote to the president asking for forgiveness. And in the same letter, she revealed that more other iron seats were stolen. Can you imagine?
Let me speak to that. The challenge with fighting corruption is that corruption is highly syndicated. There is a system that happens behind the scenes. And for us, we normally go for the face and we forget that there is a support system behind. Now, with the politicians, of course, when it comes now to prosecution, you have to present evidence beyond reasonable doubt. Now, what happens with the ministers is normally they don't leave behind a trail. It's their officers that always do the transactions, do this, do that. And so when it goes to court, unfortunately, it's these officers who are allowed to be used that end up facing
just like one minister who said the iron sheets walked into his compound.
Exactly. Now, that's a challenge. If you want to pin a minister, there has to be a trail that shows, for example, with public funds, there has to be a request, there has to be a reallocation, there has to be an approval. So if in all those documents, there is no hand of the minister, unless now you go for a dictatorial regime where you'll say so-and-so, you're implicated in this scandal, please step down.
I'm going to come to that regime that you're talking about when we're talking about Rand and why it is doing better. Yes, John, you want to respond?
Yes. David, I wanted to inform you, my friend, that I agree with you, corruption in Uganda is syndicated, multi-layered. Because you can imagine, I told you about the road from Koboko to Yumbe. Somebody in World Bank, Uganda branch, even in influencing which contractors should go and do the work, which is now the work of UNIRA. So it's not only one person, there's a chain of people doing that. Number two, I want to inform him that the political will I am talking about is in terms of political actions taken by political leader. And in this case, I'm calling upon the President of the Republic of Uganda to take political action. He wrote to us that he wants to do. The President wrote a letter.
Yes, in his December 31st address, he said that he was going to do something about the corrupt officials. I'm left with very little time. I'm going to come back to you.
Yes.
I want to ask you, why is Rwanda doing better than Uganda? Why is it above average at least?
Rwanda has put in place systems. And we will all agree that the systems in Rwanda currently, they work. if there is a case, they have certain interest within matters of development. If there is a case on resource wastage, the action is always quicker. We've seen so many people within the government stepping down, being, you know, prosecuted and things like that. Now with us, because we have now a mix of the democracy, we have a mix of the law has to take precedence. You have the things of investigations and what. Normally action takes longer, but also Rwanda has the other advantage of coordination within the agencies. So if you want to find information on corruption within Rwanda, it's much easier to get it than it is here in Uganda. Otherwise, I think we still have a bit of a long way to go if we are to improve on our perception.
On our corruption.
But everything is everything is possible if we give it
our all. Job, as I am concluding, what can we do to improve? At least next year, let us hit a 30.
Well, the systems must be made to work. We have systems here. Like the Rwanda, actually Rwanda does everything by copying and pasting what we have in Uganda, but perfecting the implementation. So the system must work in the criminal justice system. The political system must also work. If I have been found to have stolen a government property, there should be no tolerance to that effect. I must be relieved of my duty, and I must be honest enough to do that. Mm. Number two, the citizens of Uganda must wake up and realize that they are the ultimate victims of corruption. When there is the poor service delivery, poor infrastructure, compromised security, who are the most victims of this? The citizens themselves. Now, the citizens must take up responsibility and fight corruption. Mm. I am encouraging CBOs to be formed in all districts to fight corruption.
What a CBO?
Because corruption has now shifted to local
government. Try to explain to our viewers what a CBO is.
Community-based organization.
Yes.
We need community-based. There is one doing very well in that greater Busei. And it is really blowing whistle and causing a lot of problem there for corrupt people. Can you imagine accounting officer, accounted for a road where the community mobilized and raised their own resources and did the road. Then the cow in the recent Auditor General's report is reporting that the district spent 40 million on that road. In Western Uganda, Greater Busei, a cow accounted for a road done by the community as if it was done by local government. So we must therefore deal with corruption and make it very costly, my sister. Don't glorify corrupt people. I still insist the government of National Resistance Movement, where I am, must become very serious in fighting corruption. Or else, corruption will make the government hated, the corruption will make citizens hate Uganda, and the end result will be very bad for us. So it is therefore my appeal to everybody in the country, starting with the president, that it is high time we do everything to fight corruption. Because our score of 26%, is actually F9, a worst F9 in the UNEB grading system, if you are to follow that.
Sure.
Finally, I want to say that to the people of Africa, we have a country called Somaliland. Somaliland is an independent country, and it obtained independence on 26th of June, 1960. Somaliland has been under occupation of Somalia, and Africa must do everything to make Somaliland independence recognized. Somaliland is a country functioning in terms of democracy, good systems, no corruption, and I'm requesting David that next year, please try to rank Somaliland in this investigation of Transparency International. And to the people of Uganda, I love you so much. We don't have any opportunity to relax concerning corruption issues. We are all victims, and I request that you support Organization for Transparency and Advocacy Uganda. I call for funders to fund this organization. We will really do good job for the good of Uganda and for the good of humanity.
Well, thank you so much. Thank you so much, Job. Thank you so much, David, for making the time. That is all the time we had for the big issue, and you heard from the experts themselves about corruption in Uganda and what we can do to improve it, starting with you at home, whereby you can become a whistleblower. Maybe we can do better next year. We are going to take a very short break here. However, Miles Ramiti is coming back with Patricia Mulumba. She is a parenting expert. She's going to be giving you tips on parenting and, of course, dealing with school fees stress. I have been Agatha Mhaise. It is all from me. Goodbye.